Let's remain standing just a moment now for prayer. And I see many of you bringing up handkerchiefs to be prayed over. We believe in that.
Amen.
Some of the greatest things that we have to happen in these days is the international ministry of praying over handkerchiefs. Great things take place. And we're so happy for it. We're always glad to do anything that we can to help others. And I want everyone to bow with me now and we'll offer prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we are happy tonight to be alive,
yes,
to be here in the service of our God with this blessed assurance of knowing that when this life is over here, we enter into the great life beyond where all of our expectations rest.
Yes.
While we're in this journey, Lord, sickness, troubles, heartaches, lays all along the road. And there's many are suffering with these things in this day that we're living in the shadows of the coming of the Lord.
Yes.
We know that the enemy is going about like a roaring lion,
yes,
devouring what he can, for he knows his time is short.
Yes.
And now many people has brought up their handkerchiefs and laid here for their loved ones. No doubt out across the desert there somewhere is an old blind daddy and mother waiting tonight for a handkerchief to return. Maybe in the hospital is a loved one, real sick, precious little baby at home. And you know every one of them, Lord. And I'm sure that you'll grant to them their request. As I just lay my hands upon them, Lord. In the representative way of the name of Jesus Christ. And we believe that it was written in the scripture that they taken from the body of St. Paul, handkerchiefs or aprons. And it was tokens of their faith in that apostle. He's come on long years ago and is immortal tonight. But the Spirit of God remains the same for those who believe the same. And I pray that you'll grant every request. Give us a great service tonight, Lord. May your presence continue to be with us. Give to us the desires of our hearts, and we trust that it'll be all in your divine will to do this. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen.
Amen.
Be seated. Such a wonderful time of fellowship this morning in the breakfast, the ministerial breakfast. I got acquainted with many of the brethren that I never knew before, and come to find out our chairman here was an Arky. And they told me if you take all the Arkies and Okies out of California, you haven't got nothing left but a desert. So, so I kind of believe it. How many here is from Arkansas or Oklahoma? One, I sure think that's right. Well, I think some of the truest old hearts that ever beat, some of them old Arkansas shirts and Okies. I kind of hold a little to Oklahoma. My mother used to live in Oklahoma, Tulsa, when she was a girl. And now, Arkansas was when I first got started in the meetings. It was down at Jonesboro, and Moark, and Texarkana, and down to Robinson Memorial Auditorium at the Little Rock, up to Hot Springs, and all many of those places through there. Oklahoma City, Tulsa, and some of the finest people. I remember when we went to Jonesboro, it was one of my first great meetings after leaving St. Louis, and a little Darty girl was healed, which stirred the whole St. Louis. There we had tens of thousands of people gathered. We went to Arkansas, and it was the first time on a broadcast that I ever was on a broadcast. And the paper stated, I believe there was 28,000 people attending the meeting. They were all over the country for 40 miles around. You couldn't hardly get a place, but what had tents and everything. Setting, people with their children laying under old cotton trucks and holding pieces of cloth over them while it was raining. Never forget one night there. I know I don't want to get started on testimonies tonight. I'd coming from I told them I was going to pray for all of them before they left, but I sure had to take it back. And so many of you couldn't even get near them, and just kept getting more and more. The line would be for city blocks. And I remember one night I went out to pray for somebody to come down from some. That morning I prayed all night that night, standing up. I got down, couldn't stand up no longer, and just on my knees praying for them as they come by. And there'd been a shoe cobbler blind from up somewhere above, forget the name of the city now, close to Jonesboro, about 30-40 miles. And he'd been blind for years. And the Holy Spirit had pronounced him healed. And he went around, come back in line again, said, "You said, sir, I was healed. My eyes are not open." I said, "That has nothing to do with it. You told me you believe me." He said, "I do." I said, "Then why are you questioning me?" And so he said, he went on, he said, "Just keep saying, praise the Lord for my sight." And he was going home that morning about 5 o'clock, being driven by, I believe it was his son, in an old Model A car, and going up the road, and he was sitting in the back seat saying, "Praise the Lord for my sight." His eyes come open. And he just about alarmed the whole country. And so he run into the Catholic church that morning with his hat on the end of his cane, swirling around like this, praising God for having his sight. And and went over in the Methodist church, and they was going to have him arrested for disturbing the worship. Don't look like that would disturb anything, but no. So that night, I just wound my way into the platform, and I seen some ushers motioning to me, and there's a driver there. He said, "I've got 2 more trips to make tonight, bringing people in the hospital." I went outside, got through to pray for some. A woman is out there that was, they thought was dying with cancer, and she'd sold the blackberries that she'd canned to get the ambulance to bring her down. Her husband had, that's about all they had left. Made some quilts, and she sold that. The Lord healed her. She got up out of the ambulance, went out their back, went on in, tried to get to the meeting. And I couldn't get back to the door again. There's so many piled in there that about distance of this wall's the wall. And I just couldn't squeeze through. And one of the ushers come and said, "We'll pick you up in the back of the building. Nobody knows. You've been there about 8 or 10 days, and no one yet had got, many had got into the place. They'd stay there day and night, just waiting for their turn." So then I got around to the back, and I remember started raining, and I couldn't push my way through, and the crowd hardly, and trying to get to the back door where they picked me up, get to the platform again. My colored brethren and sisters, tonight you've, excuse me for this remark and the way I shall say it, but it was, in them days, they still had kind of a move of segregation in Arkansas. So I started going in, and I heard someone calling their father. And I looked, there's a nice-looking colored girl. She was blind. She was pushing her way around through the crowd, crying for her father. And no one is paying any attention to the young lady. And no one knew me, so I started pushing like this. And some fellows are standing there talking to several chartered buses sitting there from different parts of the country. There's a fellow standing there whinling, talking. And I tried to push by him. He said, "Stop pushing." And I said, "Yes, sir." And so I started to push again, and he said, "I said stop pushing." I afraid he's going to start pushing. So I said, "Excuse me, sir." So I went around this other way, and finally I got in the line of that girl. It sounded like a hypocrite to do that. But I got right where she was pushing along, and she said, "Somebody help me. Somebody help me." And I just kept getting along, you know, until she bumped into me. She said, "Excuse me, sir." And I said, "What do you want?" She said, "Would you help me find my father?" And I said, "What do you want with your father?" She said, "Well, I come over here to see the healer. And said, they tell me that I can't even get near the building, and I've lost my father. And I can't find my way back to the bus." I said, "Where are you from?" And she said, "Memphis."